Hello everyone and welcome. My name is Taylor Bug and I am the marketing coordinator here at Cloud for Good. And I'm so happy to welcome you to today's webinar, Increasing Engagement Across the Student Lifecycle with Marketing Cloud. A couple of housekeeping things before we do get started. Your lines are going to be muted today, but we will have time for Q&A after the presentation. So please be sure to submit all of your questions using that Q&A box on your screen. And if we don't get to all of the questions that do come in, we will follow up once the webinar has concluded. For those of you who don't know Cloud for Good yet, first off, thank you for deciding to spend your 30 minutes with us this afternoon or morning, depending on where you're at. We are a Salesforce implementation partner who helps those in the nonprofit and education spaces create more value. We do this by bringing over 10 years of experience working with every cloud and every use case to our implementations. We're also constantly innovating, and with our proprietary accelerators, they are designed specifically to amplify our customers' digital transformations. We're also delighting our customers, and that truly shows through our 4.9-star App Exchange rating, as well as being the 2021 Education Partner of the Year and a four-time winner of the Nonprofit Partner of the Year, which actually makes us the first and only partner to have ever received this honor. And with that, I'm so excited to introduce today's subject matter experts, Ryan and Jamie. Today, they're going to be taking you through how you can increase and measure engagement across the student lifecycle with Marketing Cloud. So thank you both so much for being here, and I'll kick things over to you two.
Awesome. Thank you, Taylor. I know I am excited to be here today. I'm Ryan Blake. I'm a senior solutions engineer at Cloud for Good, working specifically within the higher education vertical. My entire background is all higher education, my entire professional career. It started in recruitment and admissions. I spent 8 years there as a boots on the ground recruitment counselor, and then eventually became an associate director where I was helping support the communication plan and strategy. Made a shift over to central IT where we were implementing Salesforce and Marketing Cloud across the entire institution. And actually it was there that I had a really tight-knit engagement and relationship with the marketing team to really try to answer a lot of the questions that I think people wanted to know about what the digital engagement story was telling about the student student life cycle. So that's me in a nutshell, but I'll let Jamie introduce himself.
Yeah, hi, Jamie Holzhuter-Currie. I'm a Marketing Cloud architect here at Cloud for Good. I've been here for about 2.5 years. We in the digital side, we work on both higher ed and nonprofit. But before coming to Cloud for Good, I was also in the higher ed space on the advancement side of things, was there for about 7.5 years and kind of got to go through the Marketing Cloud process and learn all that Salesforce can do. And that kind of really dove me into this world, and here I am. And I'm also, I should mention, a marketing Salesforce marketing champion, which is an important credential I got to put out there for you.
Yeah, if you weren't going to mention it, I was going to call it out. So you're being humble. Before we really get into today's topic, I really wanted to start with highlighting some of the work that Cloud for Good has done. We do, as mentioned earlier, we have a dedicated higher education team working across various clouds supporting the implementation of Salesforce and Salesforce-based solutions. So not just the CRM, but thinking about Marketing Cloud and the suite of tools that exist there. And I think what's important to note is while there's a box on here that speaks specifically to marketing and engagement, when we look at this, really the student life cycle, the primary pillars of the institution, collectively, like marketing is really cross-departmental, right? It's touching each one of these areas in one way or another. Communication to some extent is touching these areas in one way or another. I think today's topic becomes really relevant in terms of the type of engagements that we can be thinking about in a variety of ways. I think it's that is what leads us into really having that dedicated practice that Jamie was talking about and the team that he's on, of being able to have a team focused on digital marketing across the various Marketing Cloud suite of tools, which does include Pardot, the tool formerly known as Pardot, which is now Marketing Cloud and Account Engagement. But it's really thinking about all of that, and that team will come in and really help organizations and institutions with supporting things like digital strategy, technical implementation, and really the breadth of requirements associated to how an institution can engage in a digital environment. And I think it's that, as I say that, I think this is where we can really start and kick off the topic at hand today, and about which we're going to focus on Marketing Cloud personalization and Marketing Cloud intelligence. So with that, unless Jamie, you have anything you want to add here?
No, I think that covers it. Basically, when it comes to digital, we do a lot of things. That's and we connect to a lot of other things. Yeah.
Perfect. So let's meet Marketing Cloud Personalization. And as we do that, I'm actually, Jamie, I'm hoping you can highlight to us what is Marketing Cloud Personalization? And I would say, let's just start there.
Yeah. And so important caveat, Marketing Cloud Personalization, before this was called Interaction Studio. You'll see that mentioned in some of our slides. You'll also see it in documentation. We'll also probably, I'll accidentally say it for sure at some point starting today. The big thing to think about with personalization is this is kind of your tool for modern marketing. So this slide does a pretty good job of describing how it works. On the left-hand side, you've got these different systems with data. So your classic ones like your CRM, your email data, Commerce Cloud is listed in here, but if we're on like a student recruiting side, maybe that's our kind of application processing, our application system. But the big one is the one at the top, and that's web behavior. So with personalization, we're able to put a cookie on the site to track what users are doing. And you could think of this kind of like at the basic level of something like Google Analytics, where people go to this and this page, they spend this much time there. But the thing that differentiates personalization is that we also are cataloging the content on the website. So not only are they going to these three pages, but we also know what those pages are about. So from there, we can start to have a sense, kind of map affinities, as they're called in the system, or interests for these individual users. And that brings us to that kind of center bubble in there, is that unified profile. So not only do we see, you know, what people are doing, how they're responding to our emails, the kind of historical information we have about them from the CRM, but we also see what they're interested in on like that kind of web behavior type of level, which, you know, is cool as a concept, but the thing that's really neat about it is what it allows us to do. So from here, we can start doing what I think of as like those modern marketing things. So on the website, we can start targeting pop-ups to folks based on what we know about them. So, you know, we're only going to show the pop-up to say, are you interested in applying, to people who are in that kind of application stage of their journey. Or maybe we'll show related resources or related events based on their behavior, kind of the, you know, the Amazon, like other people have bought something like this, or the Netflix, like other folks have watched this. So we can kind of start to serve those things. And not only in the website, we can also do it with Marketing Cloud, with emails. So if you do something on the website, we kick into a journey. If you, based on your behavior, we can also send recommendations to the CRM. It really kind of opens up a whole suite, a whole bunch of options where we've got this profile, all this data kind of mapped together, and now we can do a ton of things with it.
Yeah, and I appreciate the parallel you drew there, of because my mind started to go to of like, is this what Amazon, I don't know if Amazon is using a lot of personalization, but it's that experience, right? It's I will go start searching for these things, and related products will not only show up the next time I go to Amazon, whether I'm logged in or not, but I will also have something in my email inbox that is now saying like, hey, don't forget about this. Or I think about, I don't know why Kohl's is on my mind. Maybe just a message from them, but right there, all of a sudden, as I'm about to log off, a coupon will pop up to say, hey, get an additional 20%. I think that's the retail experience, but that student experience, obviously we know is gonna be different in terms of what we're looking for. I think the question or the follow-up question that I have, as you mentioned all that, is, you know, why does it matter and what's the value in the data that we're capturing?
Well, I mean, I think it's because of retail, we all have that experience of people knowing and understanding us. And so if we're looking at a university, whether it's one that we graduated from, you know, I think about, especially coming from the advancement side, the place where I went to school has a whole lot of information about me, knows what I studied, it knows where I live, it knows my donor history. But now if they can also layer on what my current interests are, not just, you know, I graduated with a degree in French. I'm not only interested in French things, maybe I'm looking at kind of history of the university. That helps to foster that connection so that it's not just a, you know, it's a more comprehensive, a more holistic view of the person so that you can kind of meet their needs where they are and what they're interested in that moment, rather than kind of like planned marketing calendars that we will hopefully meet them where they are.
Right. Awesome. I think with that said, I think it'd be worth going through some actual hired use cases.
Yeah.
And I think the first one, I actually kind of want to take a stab at the first one. I'm just going to put them all up on the screen here. But that first one that pops into my mind, thinking about what my past experience has been in recruitment admissions, is those secret shoppers. of coming to the website. You know, they might be really navigating through particular programs. Engineering, I think, is one that was really popular at my institution, or that is one that comes to mind. And those students may not actually sign up for a visit or schedule for a visit or fill out an RFI. And that's how we've traditionally been able to target personalized content to them, is they fill out this sometimes extensive form, we get it, and then we can send an email. But it sounds like with personalization, we can understand the type of pages they're going to, the programs mm-hmm. that they're looking at, and allow either a pop-up mm-hmm. to say like, hey, come to this engineering event, or meet with specifically the engineering faculty member, or even start to have the content and images create a personalized experience while they're on our site directly. And I think that's a prime opportunity of, particularly for those secret shoppers who are navigating yep. our website, we don't know exactly who they are, that we can get to that personalized experience without that human touch we might have once they actually do fill out a form.
Yeah, because they're like in that, you know, the secret shopper type of thing, they're showing their interest. We just don't know who they are and where to meet them. So personalization helps to kind of bridge that gap between those two.
Yeah, awesome. And the other ones I think people can see on the screen too, encouraging event registration. I think that one becomes mm-hmm. really important. Mm-hmm. Knowing how important or what yield rates look like when somebody actually visits a campus, those yield mm-hmm. rates, you know, increase dramatically. So the more we can encourage that and avoid students not being able to find it or not knowing what events are coming up, I think makes this a really relevant use case within that recruitment and admissions space.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, we don't have to go through all of them here. I think, you know, a lot of the use cases, once you start thinking about it's really the web behavior is like the key component to like be focusing on. So if there's a place where we can understand, where we can see users kind of showing their interest in some way, personalization can layer on top of that to then help connect the gaps between what you're hoping for them to do and what they're already interested in.
Yeah, I want to touch on the student success one a bit, because we're talking about interest, and I think the interest always, to me, sounds like the sales or the commercial, right? The recruitment admissions type space of lifelong learning. And I think with student success, it now becomes about retention. So one of the challenges I know institutions will have is they might be able to say, like, we know students are going to this area of the website about how to schedule appointments, health resources are available, but mm-hmm. how do we get them to do the things that we want them to do, like schedule an appointment with an advisor or mm-hmm. be able to target them with directed resources. I think this is where personalization allows for that personalized experience to come into play for retaining students, to allow them to find resources that they're searching for and have it be front and center, but personalized to the individual student and not mm-hmm. so much to collectively as a student, like, well, everybody should do this. Students may already be proactively doing some of those things.
And I mean, I would layer on top of that. So we think about advisors as sort of ambassadors or helping to kind of foster that connection. I focus a lot on the web side of things of what personalization can do, but personalization can also provide options for an advisor talking to a student. So we can have recommendation of resources. So if you have resources for like student life, whether it's, you know, kind of health related resources, I think is mentioned here, but the whole suite of things. Yeah. If that student has been on the site, has been going across different places, a recipe, which is a customizable algorithm, can serve up recommendations so that when the advisor is about to meet with the student, they can say, hey, by the way, did you see these resources? And it doesn't have to, you know, there doesn't have to be any sort of conversation of like, oh, we knew what you were doing by where you're going on the website. But it helps, it becomes an asset for that advisor, and hopefully helps to then demonstrate the value that that advisor can provide for the student to help them kind of keep coming back, because, you know, this is now a place where I can go to and I can get things that are useful to me.
That's amazing. I love that. I love that. Yeah. Well, and so Jamie, kind of on that note, and thinking about what Cloud for Good has done, you know, we did a project with Teach for America that involved marketing level personalization. I wonder if you can touch on that a little bit. Share more of what we did there.
Yeah, so we, as the slide mentions, we've done a lot of things with Teach for America, but the personalization one was really focused on the recruiting side of things. So helping to identify students that were in that recruitment phase based on their behavior on the website. So students applying to be teachers for Teach for America. So that involved, you know, the tracking, targeting pop-ups to them, especially around kind of like deadlines and things like that, serving recommended content to them in the different email journeys that they had going on. So that content would say, you know, here are resources based on your behavior on the site. Here are resources that you might be interested in. Those resources for Teach for America had things from like, you know, testimonials to like, what's it like to be a teacher to, you know, alumni resources, all those sorts of things, essentially trying to support and help encourage students along those different points of that sort of application process and that journey.
Awesome. Well, let's move on with the time we have and talk about intelligence. I think that's the next one that we want to highlight. And again, give us a highlight or an overview of what is marketing cloud intelligence.
Yep. So another formerly known as Datarama. It's recent rebranding of things, and we obviously, as you can see in the slide, we still have some references to that. But similar to personalization, Datarama or intelligence is bringing together data from a bunch of different things to then enable you to do more. So the big piece here on the left hand side, you can see a bunch of little logos from the different ad platforms. The key thing for intelligence is it's bringing together data from those different ad platforms. So if you are a marketer, or if you've worked with a marketer, you are familiar with the process of, like, say, on a monthly basis, you got to go to Google Ads, you got to go to Facebook Ads, maybe you've got data in print, maybe you've got data in Google Analytics, you got to pull down the spreadsheets, you got to put those into another spreadsheet, maybe it's a Google Sheet, so it's a little bit more shareable. You got to combine those things together. There's typically a little bit of like, oh, we don't include this campaign, we exclude this one because it's an outlier, all that sort of stuff. On a monthly basis, you kind of have to do that in order to get some sense of where are we spending our money, how are we tracking to our budget, and then hopefully if you have conversion data, like what's our ROI, or what's at least a vague sense of the ROI. The idea behind intelligence is it does all that on an automated basis, daily or even more frequent than daily, so that now you have a connected, unified, harmonized data set with a full complete data model to then from there be able to create dashboards, to start digging in, analyzing the data. There's also the option to set up, you know, actions and insights. So if this happens, then do this type of thing, you know, turn off spend on a certain ad or something like that. There's also artificial intelligence built into it. You can export that to Tableau. So you can do lots of things. But yeah, the main piece is we've got all this data, this marketing data in these different little places, bringing those together so that now we can, you know, understand it better and more completely.
Yeah, that that sounds
that was
amazing.
A lot. Sorry, it was
a lot, but I think the biggest thing that I took from it is like the manual effort that teams are putting in to get all the data from the various sources and be able to tell the story of value in what some of their marketing efforts are. And I know from my own personal experience that was some of the collaboration that we had across the institution. Is them pulling down the marketing data, wanting to see the CRM data, okay, like how many people registered for these events because of this ad, how many people were filling out RFIs, like where are we spending the money, right money in the right places, was some of the answers they were trying to, some of the questions they were trying to answer.
And if you've been kind of on that marketing side, or maybe people on the call have been the people asking this question, there's occasionally the, hey, how did that ad do, or like what, you know, that someone asked that question. And if you don't have a tool like this, answering that question can be really difficult, especially to do it quickly, because usually it's the, hey, we've got something coming up, how do we do on this last one. Intelligence has it all collected for you rather than someone needing to go down and kind of hunt through all those spreadsheets, like I said,
which I think in my mind allows you to be a little bit more flexible and tactical in terms of, right, you understand this, that this had success, we can employ this faster versus taking the couple weeks where it may not meet the timeline in terms of what you're trying to accomplish always.
Exactly.
So I'm wondering, I think it might be worth walking through some of this. We have a little bit of a kind of a walkthrough demo, but I'm going to Jamie, I'll let you lead it. So
So if you want to go to the next one, Ryan, so we just grabbed a few kind of screenshots from Datarama to hopefully help it feel a little bit more real and not this just like vague thing. And we did screenshots because of time. So in here, this screenshot, you can see we're in the connect and mix section of Datarama. That little menu across the top kind of describes the three big functionalities is connecting and mixing, bringing that data, harmonizing it. Analyze and act is where you can kind of dive into it, and then visualize, we'll see in a little bit, where you can create dashboards. But the thing I wanted to call out here is these are where we bring in our data stream. So those are those different endpoints, those different what would be like siloed spreadsheets. And this is actually from LSU Online, who I think we've got a little slide about later, who's someone that we worked with. And you can see they have 22 data streams, which is pretty average. So typical marketing team is going to have 20 plus data sources like this. And the beauty of kind of bringing these in on these data streams is we're letting the robots take care of it rather than asking someone to go and kind of do the exporting process for it. And you can see kind of the list of some of them. You know, we've got Bing, Facebook. There are a number of different kind of pre-built API connections. You can also connect to Salesforce. You can also do, you know, file drops, whether emailed or on an FTP type of thing. So lots of ways to kind of bring that data in. And if you want to go to the next slide, Ryan, we can look at this is the mapping screen of one of those data streams. So this is the Google AdWords API. So this is on the left-hand side, you've got the pre-built API that Salesforce has put together, which gives you kind of all the fields that are coming from there so that you can get that kind of daily pull of data. And then in the middle, we're mapping it to the data model. So the data model, the thing that's nice about the data model is this is a harmonized, consistent piece where we're kind of able to pull when we're creating the dashboards. The nice thing about this is from here, we can, you know, clean up naming conventions if we have certain platforms that are not very consistent. We're also ensuring that, you know, what we call an ad set in one platform is the same as an ad group in another platform. So we have that kind of apples to apples comparison. There's less training that you need to do to say, like, we always do this here except that. I definitely remember from reporting is, you know, everything is the same except for these rules that are exceptions to it. The nice thing about intelligence is we've brought it together in one common place so that when we go to the dashboards, which if you want to go to the next one, Ryan, we now have a consistent pool of data that we're pulling from. And so this is a real dashboard from LSU Online. Those are not real numbers. If they spent $1,000 and got 400,000 leads, I feel like they'd be pretty happy about that. But this just kind of gives you a quick sense of what we can get with these dashboards. Visual, quick reads, very shareable. And the nice thing about this is from here, hopefully that inspires more questions so we can dig in deeper to understand the data more and hopefully get kind of a more advanced view and understanding of where we're spending our money and how we're attributing things.
Just to touch on something that you had mentioned earlier about the pace at which you can get this data.
Yeah.
Is this like what is a common occurrence in terms of how often these would be updated?
So typically we're doing it on a daily basis. You can drop some more frequently. You could drop it slower if you wanted to. You know, if you have, let's say you've got like a file or like you get charged by your print house on a monthly basis or something like that, that could be dropped in on a monthly basis. Typically we're running it on a daily one just because that kind of meets the needs for our analytics, but there could be options if you wanted to run it more frequently, especially on like a day of giving or something like that, where if you needed to get more in the moment type of information.
Yeah, awesome. Yeah, that average cost per lead or average cost per app, that is a number that is constantly debated.
Yes.
On what does it cost to recruit a student? So I love being able to see that.
Yeah, that's the beauty of kind of this project that we did with LSU Online is they have a large ad budget. And I think we can maybe even go, is our next slide about it? I think we've got like a little success story. With LSU Online, we worked with them last fall. You know, they have a large ad budget, and they have these many different platforms that they were working with, you know, that we saw all the data streams there. But the challenge was connecting that to conversion information from Salesforce. So with intelligence, we were able to bring those pieces together. And now not only are they able to get their information more quickly, you know, I think what took in the past like 90 minutes to pull a report is now 15, yeah. You know, when you get that executive question. We're not only able to get it more quickly, we're able to get more granular, more specific, and more accurate estimates on things instead of the, well, we think this is doing pretty well because we have this one number here. We can even follow it all the way down the chain for things.
Awesome. Well, looking at the time, I want to make sure we have some time to answer some questions.
Mm-hmm.
That is all amazing. If people do have other questions, we are more than happy to follow up and have further conversations. But Taylor, I see you jump back on. Hoping you can throw some questions at us so we can help answer.
Yeah, of course. We had quite a few come in during the presentation, so we'll start off with those. But if y'all have any other questions, don't hesitate to submit them. So the first one I have here, Jamie, is do we have to be using Salesforce CRM or Marketing Cloud to leverage these tools? Will they work if we have Marketing Cloud account engagement or Pardot?
Good questions. Yeah, so CRM definitely not required. Marketing Cloud is not required for intelligence. It is required for personalization, but Salesforce does offer a SKU of like a very limited Marketing Cloud that you could talk to an AE about. There are definitely upsides if you have CRM or Marketing Cloud just because of the connections, especially with personalization, just because of the kind of additional functionality that it opens up. And from a Pardot account engagement definitely works with both of those. There are integrations between personalization as well and Pardot that can, you know, kind of open up your recruiting doors there.
So the next one I have here is for Marketing Cloud intelligence specifically. So if they're already using GA4, will it integrate with that?
It does. Both GAU and GA4, they're built-in APIs for intelligence.
Awesome. So this next one is, does Marketing Cloud personalization track and capture third-party data?
That's a great question. It is so in personalization is first-party data. It's your data. It's essentially helping you to use your data more effectively. And that's the general trend that we see with things is trying to move away from third-party data. But if you do have a third-party cookie on your site, if it's available to be captured, it can be brought into personalization to kind of shore things up. The one thing to watch out for is sometimes those are hashed in some ways. So there might be a little bit of kind of decoding that has to happen for that. But in general, if it's available on the site, personalization can capture it.
So I think we have time for one more. Do you have any tips that you could share to gain leadership buy-in when there are differing methodologies and philosophies?
Oh my goodness. Well, having worked at a large university that was decentralized, I'm very familiar with this type of question. I think the big thing to keep in mind, whether it's data wrong, like whether it's intelligence or personalization, I think both of them can encounter this type of thing, is to remind yourself of that kind of crawl, walk, run approach. So not trying to solve everyone's problems right off the bat, but trying to identify those good first use cases that meet a lot of needs that can improve, especially those kind of like automated things. And that's for two reasons. One, we're starting like in a manageable scale, a manageable scope for things, but also hopefully that helps to create that buy-in and that trust and that understanding of like, all right, this is because especially with personalization, it's a slightly different way of doing your marketing. And so having those good initial use cases makes a huge difference for then down the road because it can just inspire kind of better trust and collaboration with others. Great question, though.
Awesome. Well, thank you both. It does look like we're right at that 30-minute mark. So thank you again to everyone who was able to join us today. It's truly because of your support that we're able to continue bringing you these thought leadership webinars. We will be sending out a recording of today's webinar, so be on the lookout for that. And if you do have any additional questions, please do not hesitate to reach out, and we'll be following up with those questions that we were not able to get to today. I hope to see you all on our next webinar. Thanks again.
Thanks, so.
Thank you.